Hey everyone, welcome to another SubQuery video where I'm going to talk about many-to-many relationships. Want to learn more? Stick around and find out. Now, as always, let's jump into the documentation website. On the left-hand side, jumping into Create a Project, under GraphQL Schema. Now on the right-hand side here, we've looked at the likes of one-to-many relationships already and reverse lookups. Let's jump to many-to-many and understand what this is all about. So first of all, this can be achieved by implementing a mapping entity to connect to other entities. In the example down below, you can see we've got a person entity or an object, or in actual fact, as you can think of it as a table in SQL or Postgres. And then we've got the group entity down below as well. And this middle entity you can think of is the one that connects the two other entities together. So for example, if you've got the person entity or object, I can get the name of this person. And then I can use the groups, which is of type person group, to come down to this particular table, because this is the group down here. And then I can link or query for persons, which is of type person, which comes down here, which will then give me the name of the group. So still confused? Well, the best way to understand something new is to jump into an example. So let's do that. Now, in this example here, we're going to create a project called Council Proposal that's going to be full of voting, and it's going to demonstrate a many-to-many relationship project. So first of all, let's go ahead and initiate a standard SubQL project, and then we'll call this Council Proposals. Let's now go ahead and open up the GraphQL schema file, and we're going to remove this entity and create our own one. First of all, let me paste in the first object here. It's called proposal, and we're going to have an ID, index, account, hash, vote threshold, and block. Now you might be thinking, where did I get these from? Well, the key here is to look at the documentation. So let's jump in, and I'm going to jump straight to the events documentation here, and it's under council that we want to focus our attention on. And under propose, you can see here that I've got some fields that I want to access, such as account, proposal index, proposal hash, and threshold. And it's these values that you'll also see again when we create our mapping file. So just remember this and create this particular entity here. The next one that we'll create is the vote history. So again, let me copy this in. And again, very similar here, where we've got approved vote, we've got voted yes, voted no. And this one, again, going back to the documentation, if we go to the voted method, you'll see we've got account, proposed hash, voted, yes and no. And the last entity that we'll create is this one called counselor. And this one simply just holds the number of votes. So from here, you can see that we've got three entity objects. And when I do my query, I can go ahead and ask for the counselor ID, the number of votes, and then there's an automatic field that gets created allowing me to join to the vote history. Then I can query based on my voted yes, voted no. Then I can connect the proposal hash, which is of type proposal, to the proposal entity. and then again access the likes of vote threshold and block. And of course, I can query the other direction from proposal down to vote history down to counselor. So this middle table is like the glue or the join between the two other tables, proposal and counselor. The next thing I want to do, as always, is to jump into the manifest file, and I want to update this. I'm just going to copy the manifest file from the notebook just to save a bit of time and paste this in. What you can see is I've got two functions here, the handle council proposed event, which filters on the council module, and the proposed method. So this should be familiar now, because in the documentation, we were looking at the council event and the proposed method. And the other one would be the voted method, which you should see down here. Okay, so let's go now and create our mappings file. For my mappings file, I'm just going to delete everything and copy the final code from the workbook. And I'll walk you through this. You can see we've got our first function at the top, which is of type substrate event. And again, these fields here should be familiar because it comes from the documentation. And this is the proposal event data. And again, understanding of this will help create the schema file. So what this is doing is making the data from the blockchain available so that we can create or instantiate a new proposal object and then take each one of these parameters and the associated data and assign it to our proposal object as a variable. And then at the end, we save this. And in a similar manner, down below here, we've got the handle council voted event. And this is the payload. And down below, what we're doing is before we store the information into our object, we're doing a quick little check. This await here calls a little helper function down below. And what this does is it double checks if this is in the database. If it is not, then it goes ahead and instantiates a new object and sets the number of votes to 0. Otherwise, it just increments the vote count. So now that we have this, let's go ahead and build this first. And we'll see this in action. Let's now try and run this. And there are two ways. There's the standard docker compose command that I could run like so, but I'm going to run this locally on my subquery node. And the reason why is I want to show you what the database looks like. So let's run subquery node, use the F flag and the dot for the current directory that I'm in, hit enter. And this is my database here using pgadmin. And you can see down below my node has started. So if I do a refresh, you'll see I've got subquery underscore 15. So this is the 15th time I've tried this. And if I scroll down the tables, you can see I've got counselor, proposals, and vote history. So this is actually what happens under the covers. And if we jump into the schema GraphQL, you can do a comparison. So for counselor, you can see in my columns, I've got ID and a number of votes, which corresponds to the fields in my schema file. And of course, the same for proposal, ID, index, account, etc. And of course, vote history as well. Now, with this node started, let's go ahead and run the playground. Now, what you'll notice is that when I do run this locally, I'm going to have to run the query engine or query service. But if I run this, I'll get an error because I do need to set some parameters. This one here is that the database Sean does not exist, so I'll have to rearrange that. And then also the port is already in use. And now it should be working. Therefore, next up, let's go ahead and jump into the playground. Let's go localhost. And here we are. Let's go and check out the schema first of all, or the docs, actually. Make this bigger. And what you can see is that I can query for my counselors. Go into nodes, and then go into the likes of number of votes. So let's start off very simply by looking at, let me delete this, my counselors, nodes, and a number of votes. And there we have it. So we know that this is working. We're getting back the ID of the counselor and the number of votes. Now, what I want to do next is I can actually do a number of things, actually. From counselor, I can go into my vote histories and then traverse to my nodes and then get access to all the fields inside the vote history. So to do this, let's go vote histories, and the autocomplete is fantastic. Let's go nodes. These are just standard commands. And again, in my nodes, I've got the likes of, let's say, approved vote and voted yes, voted no. I'll run this, and there you go. So we've got, for each counselor, the number of votes that the counselor has made, and the Boolean on whether the approved vote was true or false, and then voted yes or voted no. Now, again, in conjunction with this, we can then jump from vote history and look at proposal hash. So remember, if we jump back into the code here, we're looking at going from counselor into the vote history object and then linking or jumping across into the proposal. So if we go ahead and inside my vote history, go to proposal hash, and then if I run this, I should get an error because proposal is looking for subfields. So again, if we follow the documentation here, let's go proposal hash, and then I've got access to the various fields that we should be used to from our proposal entity or object. And there we go. So this is an example of many-to-many relationships where we're traversing the table or the schema from counselor to vote histories into proposal hash. Now, the question you might be asking is, this is great, but what does it actually mean? Well, we can go into, let me run this again, go into the likes of subscan. And let's see if we can do a quick cross-check. Let's copy this out here, and I'll paste it into subscan. And you can see we've got 60 extrinsics, so let's view them all. And the extrinsics you can see are balance transfer, democracy vote. What we are really interested in is the council vote, because remember this is from the council object or the method. So let's first of all a filter on council, of which we have 11. And then what I want to do is actually include a block number. So let's go inside vote history, block, hit run. And you can see here I'm on block 2.29 million. So across here, I've got block 2.29 million. So you can see that if I expand this, we've got an index the approved is true, so this is the true here. The index I can also pull out as well. I believe it's on the proposal hash, so let's go index, run this. And there you see I've got index as a 33. This is the 33 here. My proposal is 0x03844, and that will be my proposal ID, so let me pull that out as well. There we go, the ID there is 03844. So again, this allows us to grab the information from the actual Substrate blockchain around council votes, and also in a similar fashion around council proposal as well. So what I also want to note is that in the documentation here, if we look at vote history, this is actually an automatic field that's provided to us, because if we want to rename this field, we can do so using a reverse lookup. And this was talked about in a previous video or lesson. And what I'll do is, let me quickly show you this as well. Before I do, the field down below, this very long one, is auto-generated. And note that it says it's a many-to-many connection. So this is an extra field that is auto-generated that we can also make use of, which I may explain in a future video. So as a bonus, let me go ahead and change this vote histories, that's plural, by jumping into the code again. And I'll go ahead and add this particular field in. It's called vote history underscore P for proposal. And this is using the property at derived from, which means I'm going to grab this from proposal hash, which is down here. And then I'll also add another reverse lookup field down here called vote history C. And this is going to derive its data from councillor, which is up here. So let me save this. Because I have made a modification to my schema file, let me cancel the nodes down below. And I'll have to regenerate the code. So let's go code gen. And let's then rerun this. And what you can see now is in the documentation, going through councillors, nodes, I've got my vote history underscore C. So basically it just renames what was vote histories, plural, to a name that I have customized to. And this is the neat part about the reverse lookup. So you don't actually need it, it's not mandatory, but if you want to overwrite the default naming field that's provided to you, this is how you do it. So of course, there's lots of opportunities to play around with this particular many-to-many project. You can go and traverse this from councillors to vote histories to proposal hash. You can also do the reverse. And there's many more other things you can do, such as aggregate. But hopefully this has been an interesting video giving you an insight into many-to-many relationships and building your knowledge of creating subquery projects and your knowledge of Substrate as well. Catch you on the next video.